Good morning and happy Pentecost Sunday. This is a day that we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit who invigorates us, guides us, and empowers us to continue to be part of God's ministry in the world despite our situation. And that is true for us. This church is a church that is open. We've been open. We've never closed. We've been continuing to worship God, to do ministry, participate with God in God's ministry in the world, and to pray together as a family. This has been a difficult time for us. It's tested our resilience, but our faith in Christ is stronger than ever, and we are excited about what God is doing in and through this church and in and through the people of God in this world. We are excited about what God is up to, even in a time like this. So we come to worship with expectation, with excitement, with open hearts, and we invite you to come with us, to open yourself, to encounter God, and to hear from the Holy Spirit, and to be empowered in your worship to do ministry in the world. So welcome to this online worship experience, and may you encounter God in this time. Worship with us.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Online Worship. I say this every week because it's true all the time, and that is, even though we're far apart, the Holy Spirit is the one who draws us together, especially on a day like Pentecost Sunday. Now, I don't know about you, but I am not a big fan of surprises. I have never been a big fan of surprises. Whether it was a surprise birthday party or a surprise from my boss about a new wrinkle at work or being surprised by construction on a road and having to take a longer scenic route. I've never been a big fan of surprises in any way, shape, or form. And to be honest, I think it has something to do with growing up with my younger brother, Russell. So anyway, I'm not really a fan of surprises. Well, our scripture passage today in Acts chapter 2 talks about a surprise that God brings the disciples. Now, it happens during Pentecost, so give me a chance to give you some background. This is Pentecost Sunday, and Pentecost is a Greek word that means 50th. It is 50 days after Passover, 7 weeks plus a day. And it celebrated a couple of major things. It celebrated the end of the barley harvest, it celebrated the first fruits of the wheat harvest, and it evolved over time, especially after the Babylonian captivity, which we talked about a few weeks ago, to begin to remember God giving Moses the law on Mount Sinai. So this is a huge celebration for the Jews. It's a mixture of July 4th and Thanksgiving all in one, if you can imagine the excitement around something like that. Now, Pentecost was one of three feasts during the year that Jews were encouraged to make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem for. So right now, in the city of Jerusalem, which is where we'll pick up our passage in a moment, it is packed to the gills. Shoulder to shoulder, elbow to elbow, there is no social distancing going on. Everybody is excited for the celebration. So, in the midst of that context, that's where we pick up the first part of the passage that we're going to read, which is in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, talking about the disciples. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So the first thing that we can pull out of verses 1 through 4 in Acts chapter 2 is this. The Holy Spirit shows up when we're doing other things. The Holy Spirit comes when we're involved in doing other things. And you know, if you look through Scripture, it seems like that is always the case, that God shows up when His people are involved with doing other things. Think about it for a minute. The disciples, as we talked about right after Easter, are in the upper room. They are scared to death about being arrested. Peter's sitting over in the corner trying to figure out how the tomb is empty. The Emmaus Walk folks are back now in the upper room saying, "We saw Jesus," and half believe them and half don't. They are totally consumed in their worrywartism. And in the midst of that, while they're doing something else, Jesus shows up. Or John the Baptist is baptizing one Jew after another who wants to repent and get ready for God's next thing. So he's baptizing dozens after dozens after dozens after dozens of repentant Jews. And in the midst of all of that, Jesus shows up to be baptized. Or how about the fishermen? They had been out all night and they had nothing to show for it. Their nets were empty. And now it's early in the morning. They're cleaning their nets. Peter is probably vigorously cleaning his nets, working out of his frustration after a night where nothing can be gained to support his family. Who shows up but Jesus? And he says, "Let's take the boat out one more time." And now the disciples are in Jerusalem. They're excited for the Pentecost. They were still Jews after all. They got excited for these celebrations. And as they were all involved in meal planning and event coordinating, the Holy Spirit shows up while they were doing other things and dropped right down on top of each of their heads. You know, in this COVID-19 new normal that we're in, we're doing things now that seem normal to us that weren't normal 12 or 14 weeks ago, right? And I'm wondering if you have opened up your heart and your mind to the possibility that the Holy Spirit could show up while you're disinfecting your groceries before you bring them in the house. That the Holy Spirit could show up while you're worrying about what's going to happen tomorrow. I wonder if you opened yourself up to the possibility that the Holy Spirit could show up when you're ordering a new mask online because the one you're using, it's getting a little ratty now. I wonder if you've opened yourself to the possibility that God could show up while you're doing other things. Friends, perhaps we need to make our routine that we've developed a little less routine and begin to look for God to show up in the ordinary, to show up in the routine, to show up in those things that we do almost without thinking about. Because as you look at the testimony of Scripture, that seems to be the way God and the Holy Spirit always show up while our attention is on something else. So when you're taking the laundry up the stairs, when you're mowing the lawn, when you're cleaning out the garage for the 12th time in the last 3 months, be open to God showing up there. Why? Because God shows up when we're doing other things. Now let's take a look at the next thing that we can pull out of this from Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 5. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven, right? They're there for the pilgrimage. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? How then is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" So, what else can we pull out of this, verses 5 through 12? Well, one thing we can pull out is this, and that is when the Holy Spirit works, people notice. Now, before we get to that, let me just say something about this gift of speaking in tongues, because there are just about as many opinions of the gift of speaking in tongues as there are Christians on the earth. Some people believe, for example, that the era of speaking in tongues is over. There was a time where the door was shut on that gift and it can no longer be exercised in the church. There are others like me who believe that there are some people who have the gift of tongues. Not everybody, but some people have the gift of tongues and should exercise that gift. There are others who think that the gift of tongues is available to everyone if they open themselves up enough to the Holy Spirit. And then there are subcategories under each one of those that I've just mentioned. So everybody has a different perspective when it comes to speaking in tongues. What I want to focus on today, though, is why did God choose to act? Not about the how he acted there, but why did he act? And the reason why he acted from the scripture is so that other people who did not know who God was could hear of the might and the power and the wonder of God in their own language like they never heard before. And when the Holy Spirit drops down and is on the disciples and he is giving them this gift at this moment, people automatically noticed and they asked the question, what does this mean? Or the Ed Davis translation of that passage, what in the world is going on here? I don't get it. They asked a question because they noticed God's work. You notice here that there was no announcement before the Holy Spirit came. Now hear this, God will be working in 10 minutes. Start the assembly process where indicated. No, right? God came, God started working, and people noticed. I'm wondering today, folks, are other people noticing the work of God in your life? You see, when you open yourself up to God showing up in the ordinary, we talked last week about being open to the fact that God can speak to us, to be aware that God can speak to us, like Samuel discovered, so he actually knew it was God speaking. Well, in the same sense, on a different level, we need to open ourselves up to understand that God can show up in our lives in the midst of the ordinary. And when God shows up, do we respond in a way that makes other people notice without us telling them that God is working that way? You know, Joe, you seemed so upset 2 months ago. But lately, you really seem happy and upbeat. Why is that? Or as they asked in this passage, what does this mean? Or Sally, you always seem to be so frustrated at work and so upset with our boss. In fact, you were a little scared of our boss. But I've noticed in the last few weeks, you're not upset at work anymore at all. You're not afraid of our boss anymore. Why is that? Or as they asked in chapter 2, what does this mean? Or you know, Herb, you used to use the F-bomb every other word. And in the last 3 months, I haven't heard you say it once. What's all that about? Or, as they asked in Acts chapter 2, what does this mean? You see, friends, when the Holy Spirit shows up in our life and we respond to God's work, other people notice. Other people begin to ask questions about God's work. We don't have to wear anything on our sleeve. We don't have to say, look how God has blessed me. It should be evident by our response to God showing up in the middle of doing ordinary things. In fact, people should notice the work of God in our lives, just like they noticed the work of God in the disciples' lives 2,000 years ago at the Pentecost. Why? Because when God chooses to work in the lives of people, others notice. Now, the third thing that we can pull out here is in verse 13, one verse. Take a listen to Acts 2, verse 13. Some, however, made fun of them and said they've had too much wine. That is, they said that they were drunk. The other thing that we can pull out of this passage, and there are many more, but we're just looking at a few. The next thing is that when God works in people's lives, when the Holy Spirit shows up while we're doing other things, not everybody is going to get it. That's just the truth. Remember, in Jerusalem, it is packed, elbow to elbow, shoulder to shoulder. There's not a place to stay. So when that scripture in verse 13 says, some made fun of them and thought they were drunk, that some of a packed city is a lot of people. And there were a lot of people who did not acknowledge what was going on, just made fun, did some mocking, to the point where they said, these folks must be drunk. I have lots of different conversations with people. One of the most frequent conversations I have with people is this. They will say to me, Ed, if I respond to God's work in my life, what are people going to say? What's my family going to say? What's my coworkers going to say if I decide to respond to what God's calling me to do? And my response is basically the same every time. And that is, what's important is your response to God, not what other people say about what you're doing. Now, does that mean that we blow off everybody who doesn't agree with us? No. God tells us clearly that we should seek wise counsel. But we should never let the possibility of people not understanding, we should never let the possibility of maybe even being made fun of once in a while, keep us from following what God wants us to do. So that when God shows up in the ordinary, when He shows up when we're doing other things, when He starts to work and people notice, it is guaranteed that not everybody is going to get it. And that's okay. It doesn't matter what everybody says. It's important that we respond to what God says. So in a moment, we're going to pause the video. And when we pause the video, I want you to ask yourself two questions. They'll be up on the screen. And the first question is, how can I better look for God in the ordinary events of life? The other one is, when people ask me about God's work, what will I say? See, the next part of this is Peter's sermon. And everybody makes a big deal about Peter's sermon. And should be made of it, because it's a great message. But the reason why he preached it was because the Holy Spirit worked in the first half of chapter 2, and people noticed and they asked questions. We don't need legislation in Congress to respect people who are of faith. We don't need a church vote to respect other people of faith. We simply need to respond to God. And when we respond to God, other people will notice, and other people will ask questions, and that'll give us the chance. That will give us the chance to share the hope that we have in Jesus. So ask yourself those couple questions as we pause the video now. Folks, God is alive. God is working right now. We need to make sure that while we're doing other things, those other things don't block our eyes and clog up our ears so we can't see or hear what God is doing. God is as real right now in your living room as He is in the sanctuary that I'm sitting in right now. God is as real in May of 2020 as He was in that Pentecost celebration in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. Allow for the possibility that God can show up while you're doing other ordinary things. And know that you're responding correctly because people will notice. And you'll be able to give the hope that we have, regardless of what other people say. Regardless of if people say, oh, their religion is a crutch because they're weak. Or they're just using it as an anesthetic to block some pain in their life. Or they grew up in a Christian home. They don't even believe what they're saying. They're just parroting what they learned. I mean, you hear all those different kinds of things. But God shows up when we're doing ordinary things. When He does, people notice and ask questions. Regardless of if everybody gets it or not. Yeah, we're in a new normal. Yeah, our minds are preoccupied with all kinds of fear and alternate planning. But the reality is, God's at work. Notice Him, because He is showing up in your ordinary. Let's pray. Lord, it's overwhelming to think that You love each of us equally. It's overwhelming to think that when our minds are on everything else but You, Your heart is still directed at each of our souls. Thank You, Lord, for showing up in ordinary other things. Help us to respond in a way so that others notice Your work and can hear the same love of God that they heard there in Acts chapter 2. You are real, Lord. Let us receive You into our real life circumstances every day. And for that, we'll give You honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. And so, as the people of God, let's worship together. Darkness closes in, You are hope. Happy Pentecost.